Hello, my name is John. I'd like to welcome you to tonight's program, L'Hiver Taan de l'Année, Métis Winter Festivities, presented in partnership with the Lougheed House and the Chinook Country Historical Society. The duration of this program is an hour and a half. If this is your first Zoom program, you can relax. We've muted everyone and that sort of thing, so you can just sit back and enjoy the program. If you have any questions, we do encourage you to share those with us. Just use the chat feature that can be found at the bottom part. I'll be monitoring that, and in the last half hour, we'll get to as many of those in our question and answer periods. So just type them in as you get them. I would now like to introduce Holly Ron from the Lougheed House. She's the Programs and Volunteer Manager at Lougheed House Conservation Society.
Good evening, everyone. To begin our digital gathering tonight, I would first like to acknowledge that we are hosting this presentation within the ancestral and traditional Indigenous territories of the Blackfoot Confederacy, including the Siksika, Piikani, Kainai, and the people of the Treaty 7 region in southern Alberta, which includes the Tsuut'ina, Îyâhe Nakoda nations of Chiniki, Bearspaw, and Morley. The city of Calgary-Mokinsis is also home to the Métis Nation of Alberta, Region 3. Speaking from my personal experience as a settler within these territories, I've never been more grateful for the land that we live on and the gifts that it has for us, as well as the wisdom from the people I share this land with, more than in this past year. And I'd like to offer my personal gratitude and thanks for our opportunity to gather and share this evening. On behalf of the Lougheed House Conservation Society, I would like to take a moment to thank the Chinook Country Historical Society and the Calgary Public Library in being our partners in tonight's digital event. It is also with great pleasure that I introduce our presenter this evening. Matt Hilterman is a Métis researcher and public historian with a specialization in Métis ethnohistory. Since 2008, he has worked at a variety of museums and heritage sites, including Heritage Park, Fort Edmonton, and Fort Calgary. Currently, Matt is working as a historic researcher with Métis Nation of Alberta Region 3 while pursuing a master's in heritage resource management through Athabasca University. Now in 2019, I was lucky to first meet Matt when he co-curated the exhibit From Racialization to Peoplehood, Exploring Métis Identity Past and Present with Caroline Lowen, who is our curator at Lougheed House. Since that time, I have really valued every opportunity I've had to work with Matt and learn from him. His passion for Métis history and culture and his dedication to community and community building is really incredible. Along with being a devoted researcher, he is also an accomplished artist and artisan, and I invite those of you who are interested to follow him on social media so that you get a chance to see all of his finished weaving projects as he creates them. And now, without further ado, please help me welcome Matt Hilterman.
All right. Well, welcome, everybody. We have quite the series of stories in store for you tonight. When I first started researching this subject, I had no idea how much information was out there on the Métis festive season. And really, somewhat unfortunately, I haven't been able to fit it all in because there is so much. But I do hope that what I present to you tonight will at least give you a bit of a sense of what Christmas and New Year's, and like were like for the Métis people of Red River in the Northwest. So without further ado, I shall begin our PowerPoint slash presentation. Also, can I just say how excited I am at how many paintings exist of this? It's really quite something else. There we go. Perfect. All right. So, Miyeur Taan de l'Année, the most wonderful or best time of the year, Métis winter festivities in the 19th century. Now, I had hoped to actually draw some continuity from the 19th century events to today, but unfortunately, there just wasn't enough time or space to get it all in because, as I mentioned, there's a ridiculous amount of literature on the subject. So we're mostly going to be focusing in on the 19th century. Now, let's set the stage. It's been a long year for you. It's been a long year for all of us, not in the 2020 COVID sense, but long in different ways. When the ice on the rivers began to break up, you go out onto your trap line. You want to make sure you've got some quarry for to trade away and to, you know, make a bit of extra income on the side. Once the trading's done, the pelts are sold, and the boats are headed downriver, you then go out to your, now this is more specific to Red River and the Saskatchewan settlements, you go out to your fields and you start to plant your crops. Or if you're an uplander at one of the forts, you might sign aboard one of the voyageur troops and move goods up and down river over the spring and summer. Following as well the spring crop planting, there's a very good chance you're going to go out on the summer buffalo run. Having harvested all your buffalo, you return from the hunt with all your cargo, ox trains and all. Now, after people get back to the settlement with the quarry from the first hunt, some will go out for a second fall hunt, while others we'll begin the harvesting process back at Red River or the Saskatchewan settlements. The harvesting and milling and the fall hunt take about the same amount of time. And just a quick side note, they actually tended to happen concurrently and even within the same communities. The biggest difference really between them is the economic orientation of the family. Some families were more invested in agriculture, others were more invested in the hunt. Regardless, you would have done one or the other for the most part. Then finally, once you've done your trapping, planted your crops, gone for the buffalo hunt, harvested your crops, gone for the second hunt, or milled your crops, you start hunkering down for winter. So you're going to start haying or cutting wood. In fact, one source I read researching this stated that chopping wood for the winter was the biggest pursuit or use of time in December. Because, let's be real, if you're doing a winter on the Canadian prairies in a period before natural gas central heating, you're going to need a lot of wood. So, you know, that's been your year. But now it's mid-December and things are starting to quiet down. Real quick, I got these slides out of order. real quick, there are some differences between Fort Christmases and Settlement Christmases. They follow the same general strokes, with the main difference being that settlement Christmases tend to be longer periods, from about a week before Christmas till a week after New Year's, whereas Fort Christmases tend to be a bit more constrained in their time span, usually just spanning from Christmas to New Year's. Though it should be noted that what Fort Christmases lack in time to make up for an intensity, but more on that later. So anyways, you've done all this work, you've been working hard all year. Now it's time to relax. You know, you've got your buffalo, you've got your pemmican, you've got your crops harvested and milled, you've got your wood cut, you've got pretty much everything you need. And now it's time really to set in for Christmas. Now, while some people in Red River would start celebrating as early as a week before the big day, both Paul Kane and Bobby Ballantyne mentioned that hunting, among other preparations, continues pretty much up until Christmas Eve. As well, while you're sort of relaxing and waiting for Christmas, you start to notice people trickling in to the settlement or fort. And when I say people traveled a long way to be around their communities at Christmas, I am not exaggerating. Peter Erasmus mentions folks coming all the way from Fort Chipewyan up by like Lake Athabasca to Fort Edmonton for Christmas. And Louis Goulet actually recounts traveling over 300 miles in the lead up to Christmas. So it's a big deal. You want to be there. Of course, you want to be there by Christmas Eve. So most of the festivities up to that point are a little lower key, mostly because a lot of people are still traveling. And so, you know, you're waiting for people to slowly trickle in. Yeah. And as I mentioned, the festivities start about a week beforehand at Red River. People don't all show up a week beforehand. They kind of move in slowly, but at the forts, Christmas Eve is when it really begins. Oh, yeah, I guess I forgot that part. So Christmas Mass. One thing that comes up a lot is that whereas Christmas was really more of a church holiday, New Year's was the big party day. And in fact, that's a big part of the reason I decided to name this presentation Winter Festivities rather than Christmas Festivities. Christmas was a big deal, don't get me wrong. And there were secular aspects to it, but it did largely have more of a religious aspect to it. So the first real event of the Christmas season was Midnight Mass. And this was a Catholic festival, as it were. I actually looked it up because I was curious. Apparently, in circumstances where they aren't competing with other churches, Anglicans and Methodists do in fact have midnight masses as well. But in the context of Rupert's Land, and particularly Red River, which were majority Catholic, you kind of let the Catholics have midnight mass and you get to have mass the next day. And this wasn't just a matter of acquiescence. One of the interesting things that came up a lot was that, so where there was only one denomination, whatever that denomination was, Catholic, Anglican, Methodist, would have mass, have midnight mass on Christmas Eve. But whenever there were multiple denominations, you would see it split up with Catholics on midnight mass and Protestants the next day. And the reason for that largely had to do with the fact that both denominations, or all denominations, tended to attend every service. Bishop Taché, in his reminiscences, notes that about half the attendees at the St. Boniface Midnight Mass were in fact Protestants. Similarly, Peter Erasmus notes that that when there was a Christmas Mass held at Fort Edmonton in 1856, everyone attended the Protestant service as well, regardless of affiliation. Heck, even John McDougall, who was a Methodist minister, managed to attend the Midnight Mass at Fort Edmonton in 1862. People just went to both. Yeah, and I think a big part of the reason a lot of people attended both has to do with the fact that there were a lot of intermarriages between Catholic and Protestant Métis historically. Some historians like John Foster have tended to treat them as, you know, separate silos or different ethnic groups, you know, using Métis only to refer to French-speaking Catholics and using country-born to refer to English-speaking Protestants. But Irene Spry, among others, has really done a good job of critiquing and contradicting this claim, showing that, in fact, there was a significant amount of marriage between English-speaking Protestant and French-speaking Catholic Métis. And in fact, speaking from my own family tree, on my dad's side, they're mostly Scotch Métis, but we still have ancestors from the Brelan family. Whereas on my mom's side, who are mostly French Métis, we still have one line of Andersons. So yeah, definitely a lot of they weren't separate as they're often portrayed. And I think that's a big part of why a lot of people and a lot of families attended both services. So yeah, Christmas Mass is what really kicked off the season, especially at the forts. Now, the next day, there were a wide variety of events. I didn't actually put this into the PowerPoint, but I'm going to mention it anyways. Wake up was often quite something to experience. See if I have this account handy. Oh, sorry. I'll give you guys the PowerPoint back. Yeah, so wake up could be quite something else. Bobby Ballantyne recounts being awakened by Thomas Charles in a pillow fight. And Peter Erasmus, oh my God, I love this account so much. All right, where is it? Approximately my own age, da 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 da. Dogs, men. There we go. So, where is it? Yeah, so Erasmus describes his Christmas morning at Fort Edmonton like so. I was aroused from a deep sleep by a tremendous blood-curdling noise that actually seemed to vibrate the room. For a moment, I was shocked motionless. Then music sounded into my senses. I was in bed and scrambled for my clothes. Bill was already dressed. John Graham, a Scottish employee, burst into the room, almost incoherent with excitement and fairly dancing for his joy. "Finally," he shouted at the top of his voice. The pibroch. He motioned for me and Bill to come. We dressed in seconds that morning and followed him as he turned and dashed for the door, striding back and forth on the walk. That surrounded three sides of the factor's three-story building was a man by the name of Colin Fraser, playing a set of bagpipes. The long droning notes that precede the actual music were what had awakened me so suddenly. He made a striking figure, dressed in all the gay regalia of a tartan and kilt, his knees exposed to the elements. He seemed quite indifferent to the weather that was at least 30 degrees below zero. And that's Fahrenheit, by the way. The deep notes of his instrument echoed back from the high hills of the ice-covered Saskatchewan River. It was beautiful to my unfamiliar ear. Never till then had I heard the bagpipes played. I turned to the face of our old friend and felt some deep sense of loneliness marked in the features of this old man. He now realized that it was too late to ever return to Scotland. He stood with his hand on Bill Borwick's shoulder. Unashamed tears flowed down his cheeks. That night, Bill and I carried him to his room as he was too inebriated to manage his own way. I seem to recall there being something about him quickly revising his opinion of the instrument, but here we are. So that's mourning. Then, of course, like I said, there's the Anglican or Methodist Mass. And at the forts, they would sometimes have a salute and a flag raising. And by salute, I don't mean like military arms up. I mean, 21 gun salute. It was quite the event. During the day, sports and recreation really dominated. So you'd have horse races, dog sled races, foot races, yes, even in winter, and tobogganing, among other things. One sport that came up a lot when I was researching this was football. Now, I'm not sure what they meant by football. Eliza McDougall mentions that it is not the football of today. Now, I'm not sure in that context if she means Canadian / American football or soccer, or if it's neither of the above. But if anyone out there has any information on Red River Rules football, please let me know. I'm super curious. Apparently a variety of football was played as a winter sport in Red River and at many of the forts. So I thought that was really neat. Of course, there's also socializing and calling. So calling involved going from house to house and visiting neighbors. These visits were typically about half an hour long, and visitors were welcomed really with the best food and drink that the hosts could provide. Community members would be expected to accommodate guests according to their means. Thus, as you can imagine, the wealthy were frequently called upon during the season, so much so that folks like James McKay and Sandy Logan, visiting their or calling their houses at Christmas, became a regular tradition for most Red River families. And I should mention that while this account is from Red River, Peter Erasmus describes something similar at the married men's quarters at Fort Edmonton. So there's clearly a degree of continuity with calling there as well. Now, the feast. For how much this plays into all the accounts I read, I'm actually a little disappointed that this was the only image I could find, because feasting was a huge part of Métis Christmases. Now, the food was a little bit more contingent on what was locally available, both in terms of that year and in terms of that region. But there are a few recurring themes. Some popular dishes that come up again and again are beef, partridge, goose, buffalo, the buffalo hump or boss at the back, and the buffalo tongue were specially prized. Also, when I say moose, specifically moose nose, which is not just a pastry, but was actually a game dish for special occasions like this. On top of that, turnips, bread or bannock, and plum pudding came up an awful lot. Most of these make sense. You know, you're whether you're in the bush or at Red River, there's a lot of meat in your diet. But plum pudding really caught me off guard. It came up so much, I really cannot but say that it was an important part of the Christmas festivities. Some other food that were eaten for Christmas include rabbit. One source notes that they could be cooked up to 16 different ways. Mutton, ham, pie, salt pork, white fish came up a few times, beaver tail, also the actual tail of beaver, not just the pastry. Potatoes, one place had antelope steaks. It was pretty varied, but it was it was pretty varied based on what was locally available. One story though that really made my day is that in 1870, the Wolsey expedition found their way out to Manitoba. Of course, these guys are military, so they're not hunting their own food, they're not farming, they're not trapping. So their rations are pretty raw. But this account, this is amazing. So they talk about first about horse racing and about how two races were going down the Assiniboine in opposite directions with different people, like completely unrelated races. And they collided, resulting in one of the horses getting impaled. Subsequently, the Wolsey expedition enjoyed a very nice dinner of beef. To put it mildly, this beef was not of the cattle form and had in fact been taken from the casualty of the earlier incident, much to the chagrin of the military men quartered there. Anyways, that was just a fun little, the title of that story was A Christmas to Remember. And boy, with a dinner like that, I can't imagine how you'd forget it. But yeah, no, it's interesting to note that like a lot of the newcomers, especially those that didn't hunt or farm or trap for themselves, actually ended up eating much less nutritious Christmas dinners than the Métis and First Nations, who really knew how to get the good food. So that happened. Now, the dance. This is a big deal. If you've ever spoken to a Métis person about like anything Métis, dancing is a huge part of our culture. And I would argue it was even more so historically before things like the radio came into play. Really every account that I consulted of Christmas at Red River or the Forts seems to indicate that the dance, the ball, was the highlight of Christmas and the week before Christmas and the week after Christmas and New Year's Eve and the week after New Year's Eve. But the Christmas and New Year's Eve balls were really the big ones. I believe this is, what's the author of this one? Just want to make sure I get this right. Alexander Sutherland recounts, "Those were the days of real Christmas, of feasting and dancing, when the dishes were scarce off the supper table before the fiddle began to twang and wine in protest of the long drawn out tuning process. How the dancers did pirouette and weave in and out of the mazes of Money Musk or the Red River Jig until swift, free-footed moccasins scarcely seemed to touch the floor in a final frenzy of the Highland Ring." So the dance. And oh man, I love the visual record here. You can see even from the most basic paintings to the most complex compositions, you get that same energy of people facing each other and lining up for jigs and reels on end. And what really amazes me is how far apart these images are from. This one, I believe, is from Athabasca or Peace Country. This one is from the Upper Peace in Northern BC. This one, I believe, is Devil's Lake. And this one is at Red River. And in spite of the huge geographic distances that separate these places and the different art styles of the artists who produce them, all of them evoke a very similar feel. Whether it's the clothing, you know, you see the capotes and buckskins, the moccasins and leggings, the fiddle. It's amazing how much continuity there was across this huge geographic space. And honestly, you see this with a number of features. While the finer points vary when it comes to Métis Christmas festivities, the broad strokes do tend to be the same, you know, with people coming in just before Christmas, you've got your initial Christmas Eve and Christmas Day masses, you have your sporting events during the days and your balls and dancing at night. Yeah, so. Harry Webster writes, "Those who were lucky enough to be able to leave the forts and go to headquarters for Christmas," in this context, headquarters would be the district capital. So as I mentioned earlier, Peter Erasmus talks about Christmas at Fort Edmonton. you had people coming from every post in the Upper Saskatchewan and Athabasca Peace Country for that. So this account is actually for well in the upper Peace around Williston Lake in northern BC. But the author writes, those who were lucky enough to be able to leave their forts and go to headquarters for Christmas have lots of fun. Among other things, there is invariably a ball, a legible, I couldn't make out his handwriting, different thing to a civilized ball. The voyageurs and laborers were all quartered together with their wives and daughters, brackets, all Métis, as there were no pure white women this far north. The dancing consists entirely of jigs and reels and the music of the violin and drum. I'm going to pause real quick there, because before I undertook this research, I had always been under the impression that Métis fiddlers, prior to the introduction of the guitar, played alone, but I actually found three different accounts of fiddle and drum at Christmas. So that was kind of neat. Back to the account. So there's jigs and reels and the music of violin and drum. All the women sit on one side of the room and the men on the other. The man chooses his partner, dances the jig or reel, and takes the fair one back to the other side of the room. The woman never utters a word, always looks as demure as possible, though when not in such formal social settings, the reverse seems to be quite true. That's the source, not me, by the way. Webster. The men, on the other hand, yell all the while they dance. The dresses are most amazing. The women with thinly beaded leggings and gorgeous silk kerchiefs on their heads. Calico dresses. And the men in the flashiest of leggings and their skillfully worked deerskin coats. All people here wear moccasins. Now, this commentary on the dress is universal. I found one source that didn't discuss Bobby Ballantyne, by the way, if you're wondering, how intense the clothing was. Incidentally, I thought I would dress to suit the occasion. Got my floral print ribbon shirt, trimmed coat, toque, sash. Yeah. So if anyone is wondering why I'm dressed as I am, it's just a matter of carrying on tradition, as it were. So there's a little bit of an account of the ball, which was really the highlight of Christmas Day. Now, throughout the coming week, it was a lot more of the same. More sports, more calling friends and families, more dancing and visiting friends. Throughout this week, dancing and other such events were usually held at private homes throughout the settlements or within the fort, rather than having a big do-up at a big central location. The big central events, you know, whether they were at the Great Hall or at the cathedral or wherever else, were largely reserved for the Christmas and New Year's dances. Now, with Christmas out of the way, let's get to New Year's. It was actually known by a lot of people as Kissing Day. The transcription I have from one account says Ochetoe Kisgo, but my Cree is not up to snuff enough to know if that's right. Suffice to say though, yeah. So New Year's Eve, there were big dances, even in Red River at Fort Garry, as well as a number of more localized celebrations at community leaders' homes. I know John McKay, for example, was known to have a very big, or not John, James McKay, was known to have a very big Christmas due up. But it was New Year's Day that was really the Red River traditions, Métis traditions around New Year's Day bring a whole new meaning to New Year's kisses. Gerhard Enns writes, from early morning until dusk, the men traveled from house to house in their best capotes, sashes, and hats to receive a New Year's kiss from all the women and girls of the settlement. After the obligatory kiss, they received the best food and spirits the house had to offer. Now, this is really interesting if we interpret the winter festivities in the academic context of the study of festivals. And we actually did kind of broach this earlier with regards to how the wealthiest families were expected to be called upon the most and to gift people, the rest of the settlement, really with the most goods. But a lot of festivals involved the reversal of or suspension of social norms. And I mention this for a couple of reasons. The first being that the record that I found for most kisses on Kissing Day belonged to a fellow who would eventually go on to become the Archbishop of Red River. But on top of that, it wasn't just the men going out to kiss the women. Both Ballantyne and Granny McDermott recount stories of women going calling too. So for a society that was very serially monogamous, the events of Kissing Day were something of a suspension of those usual social norms. And actually, I have a bit of a story here since we seem to be doing pretty good for time. Granny McDermott's recollection of Kissing Day at Old Kildonan. She writes, I remember New Year's celebration much better than Christmas Day. Christmas Day was a church holiday, but everyone celebrated New Year's as the big day in the year, whether Scotsman, French, or Indian. I am going to tell you about one New Year's Day when I was a young girl about 18 years old. Mary, my sister, and I started out from our sleep in the morning by the sound of nearby shots. Again, the salute. A lot of the, I should note, a lot of the events or traditions around both Christmas and New Year's Day, and really the time in between before and after, are a repetition of the same cycle. So, you know, there's a few things here and there, like the mass on Christmas Eve and Christmas, or the kissing on New Year's, but largely you're seeing a lot of the same things, including the salutations. So that's what the shots are. So she says, we were startled from our sleep by the sound of nearby shots. Then we remembered it was New Year's. Some of the young men were welcoming New Year's by firing their guns into the air. We soon got up and went downstairs to help my mother. We would soon have plenty of visitors. New Year's, much like Christmas and again, all the other times, there was a lot of people going to call, house to house, door to door, you name it. Indeed, before breakfast was over, our first one arrived. He was a tall old Cree man, dressed in his best clothes. He was wearing a fringed buckskin suit, brightly decorated with beads. On his head was a fully feathered headdress. His long back black braids had red and green ribbons woven into them. Father welcomed John Hunter into our home. That was the Cree fellow. He gave him some tea and some raisin-filled cakes. The old chief nodded and smiled when he saw the raisins in the cakes. He stayed for about half an hour. Then he left to visit other Kildonan homes. Before the morning was over, we had many other visitors, both Indians, Métis, and whites. Of course, in the afternoon, Mr. Colin Christie, one of the Kildonan's young men, called to take, that is, dropped by, to take Mary and me for a sleigh ride. Mr. Robert McDougall, a young visitor from Eastern Canada, and several other young folks were in the sleigh too. The horses pranced and the bells jingled, and off we went skimming over the snow. "Let's call it the Cree Village," suddenly cried out one of the girls. "They like to visit us on New Year's. Let's visit them too." "A fine idea," we all agreed. Mary wanted to go to John Hunter's house because he was the chief, and so Colin drove the horses in that direction. On and on we went, lapping and singing, our runners stretching on the hard, dry snow, until at last Colin stopped the horses on the edge of the village. Does this remind anyone else of Jingle Bells? Because I'm getting some serious Jingle Bell vibes here. Anyways. "Come on out, all of you," said Colin. "Let's celebrate Ochetoe Kisco with our Cree friends." "What does that mean?" asked Rob. One of the girls told him Ochetoe Kisco was the word for kissing day. Once a year, on New Year's, the Cree would kiss their friends and enemies too. We walked past several groups, everyone nodding their head and smiling to one another until we reached Chief John Hunter's house. This is a quick sidebar, but the Cree and Anishinaabe who lived at Red River lived in houses as well. A weird thing that people kind of just assumed that they were still living in teepees even though they were settled at Red River and farming. But yeah, Chief John Hunter's house. Colin knocked loudly on the door and we heard a stum, which means come in. So we entered. If the chief was surprised, he didn't show it. He welcomed us as kindly as my father had welcomed him in the morning. His two daughters, about my age, seemed shy. They stayed back in the shadowed corner of the room. However, at a nod from their fathers, the girls, together with Mrs. John Hunter, came forward and shook hands with all of us. Mrs. Hunter gave us all cups of black tea. We ate lunch, and we ate the lunch we had brought with us. We visited them for a short time. They could speak very little English, and our Cree was different than theirs. The boys and the old chief tried to talk by grunts and nods and smiles. We girls needed only to look at each other. I'm afraid we were rude, but the boys and the old chief were a funny sight, but it was getting late now, so we got ready to leave. Colin, who had gone to get the sleigh, now drove it up to the door. As we were getting in, the two shy girls ran over to Rob, the new young man from the East. Throwing their arms over him, they each gave him a loud smacking kiss that made our horses start off as fast as the wind. Some of the folks nearby laughed loudly. So did all of us in the sleigh. Poor Rob's face turned as red as fire. It was a long time before we let him forget Ochetoe Kisco. So, yeah, fun little story there. Now, another New Year's tradition, and this one's interesting because it's whereas almost everything else is shared, not just by the entire Métis community, but also the Europeans and First Nations in the immediate proximity. This one is very specific to French Métis, and it's paternal blessings. Basically, the whole family, all the adult children, would go to the patriarch's house on New Year's Day to receive the father's blessing for the year. Invariably, this blessing would be followed by a sumptuous dish of tortillas. Now, of course, there's the races. Just as much as sport was big on Christmas and the whole season, the New Year's races, I'll put it this way. If you think of the Christmas season as being a series of sporting events, you can think of the New Year's races as the finals. Although horse and dog sled races continued throughout the season, the New Year's Day event really were the highlights. And if I have time, I might actually come back to this slide because So really evocative account from Peter Erasmus about it. But yeah, the New Year's races were a big deal. And it does that on all of them. And yeah. But the festivities didn't just end with New Year's, just like they didn't start with Christmas Eve. Here's the thing. Weddings, so most of the year in the Métis seasonal round was super busy. And there weren't a lot of times to sit down and get married or, you know, do that sort of business, especially because Métis wedding receptions were notoriously long. We're talking 4 days to a week. They were events in and of themselves. Like, there's stories about people basically, like, you know, fiddlers tag teaming it in 8 hour shifts. There's stories of people going outside in the middle of winter to cool off from the dance because it gets so lively in there. So these are the kinds of things we're seeing in this this seasonal revelry, which is like, I think it's a lot of fun. But yeah, so, and as Gerhard Enns notes, the winter season, particularly the festive season, was a season of abundance among family and friends with time on their hands. And the season of abundance bit is true both in the large number of family and friends with time on their hands, but also going back to the beginning here, the fall hunt had just returned. The harvest had just been milled. You know, there was ample food and drink to go around. And this just seemed like, you know, a really good time to keep the festivities going. And so a lot of people chose to get married around this time of year. Though people began to return to work or home after New Year, the festive season continued as long as Epiphany. And though weddings were not uncommon throughout January and February, they sort of tapered out in March once the economic realities, you know, once basically you got to get back to work. But yeah, the whole period from about mid-December to mid-February was characterized by a string of festivities, Christmas, New Year's, weddings, just everything you can imagine. It was truly the most wonderful time of the year. Now, since I see I'm running a little early, I'm actually going to go back and read that Peter Erasmus dog sled account because I really enjoy it, and I'm sure you will too. So Peter Erasmus, really cool guy. I've cited him a lot in this presentation. He was basically a Métis Renaissance man. He was a hunter, trapper, trader, freighter, farmer, missionary, gold miner, interpreter. Did I say interpreter already? He was said to have spoken 7 languages. Just a generally all-around smart and skilled individual. And one account of his skill comes not from his intellect or his acumen in a more professional sense, but from his sheer athleticism here. So Erasmus says, there were foot races, toboggan slides on the North Saskatchewan River Hill, and some competitions among the women, most likely games like double ball. Sorry, that was my insertion. But the big event was a dog train race of 3 miles of the river. Every team from each post competed in this race. Each factor contributed his share to the prize, and the winner took all. Oh yes, a lot of these races were gambling matches, to be sure. The winner took all, which was a choice of clothes and stocks, or in stock, to the amount of approximately $25 in 1856 money. Now it's hard to convert $25 into modern money, but ballparking, I'd say, probably around 2,500, so not a bad prize. The employed dog drivers for the company at Edmonton asked the factor if they could allow me to drive one of their 2 dog teams. He consented, provided the other leaders agree. They readily consented as they considered me poor competition against their own hardened, skillful drivers. Bill Borick heard about the arrangement and came to me with the intention of talking me out of it. Man, you haven't a chance in the world against these men from Jasper House in Athabasca. 50 miles a day is a regular run for them. They'd be ashamed if they were caught riding. They're tough, strong young men. Heck, man, that's all they know, just running behind dogs all winter. Bill, I'm going to beat every last one of them, and I'm going to tell you how I aim to do it, I said. This is Erasmus talking. Every driver has been idle, eating and drinking to the limit of his capacity all week. The dogs are the same. We will be in good condition for a short, fast race. Our dogs are in worse. Oh, I think that's backwards. Our dogs are in worse shape. The team I drive has made the trip to Lac Saint Anne this week. They're not overfed or rested enough that they they are not overfed and they are rested enough to be keen for tomorrow's run. Bet your shirt, Bill. If I lose, I'll give you one of mine. Besides, I don't drink, and I think that's my biggest lead over the others. The latter remark was really just a dig at Bill's private opinion on drinking. But I had considerable faith in my ability as a runner, for I had won foot races against some pretty strong competition. My trips for the post after game and fish had kept me in good condition. And Pierre, the driver for the second Edmonton team, had urged me to enter the race. Peter, by gar, you're the best runner in these parts. You never drink the whiskey. Well, them men, they drink. And they eat and they feed the dogs like pigs. They're lazy as hell. All the week. For sure you win that race, maybe. Also, I just want to point out that that is not me intentionally inserting a French accent. That's literally how it's recorded in Erasmus's autobiography. So don't shoot the messenger, I guess. The starting point was marked by stakes in the ice, far enough apart to accommodate the seven teams at the line. 1.5 miles down the river was another set of stakes, three in number, around which we must drive before returning to the starting line. Failure to pass the stakes would disqualify the driver. There were judges at this end and watchers at the other to make sure the drivers complied with the rules. No man was allowed to foul up another driver or cut in unless he had a clear lead to the trail that would be well marked on our trip downriver. We were off. Bill was my helper at the post. I'd given him instructions to hold the dogs back until at least a half of the others had started. They would be plowing the snow on an untraveled track. Bill, disgusted at the foolish way of starting, nevertheless obeyed. There were four teams in the lead, all abreast for the first 200 yards or so. The Jasper man had the same idea as I had. He was holding his dogs back, to the track already made by the other four toboggans. One man left at the post as his dogs, in their eagerness, had fouled up their harness. I could see that the man from Jasper would be my strongest competitor. What none of the other drivers knew was that there was a stretch of overflow ice, at least half a mile of course downriver, that I hoped to pass the others without plowing deep into the snow. Pierre, our other Edmonton driver, was now in second place behind the Fort Pittman. We were all closely bunched together when we made the turn, but I got ahead of the fourth team as his dogs cut short instead of rounding the marker posts, and he had to turn his dog. I was now in third place with the Jasper man directly behind me. When I came opposite the overflow ice, I struck into the deep snow as if to pass the team. He started to follow me, but seeing the depth of the snow, he turned back. The minute I reached the thin snow on the overflow ice, I cracked my whip over the dog's back and yelled. They almost threw me off the sleigh with that increased speed as I climbed the sleigh to get the weight. Now ahead of all the others, I allowed myself plenty of room before cutting back to the track. I had the race if I could stand the pace that I was being forced to travel to hold my lead. I had a brief breather while riding the overflow, but jumped off when I came to the now well-marked trail. The Fort Pitt man was close behind me, and I knew that I had to outdistance him before we reached the last quarter mile, because then he would also have a broken path to follow. Now, for the second time since starting, I cracked my whip over the dogs, yelling for more speed. Not hitting them, but my voice and whip urging more speed. I did not dare look behind me at the others, but I was content with side glances only. For to tell the truth, I had no breath to spare nor energy to worry about opponents as long as I could see no driver ahead. We were only 100 yards or so from the starting posts when another side glance showed the Fort Pitt man getting beside me, his lead dog almost opposite my toboggan front. Only the short distance ahead would save the race for me, as I had the limit of speed out of my dogs. I hit the finish line with only a two-dog advantage above my opponent. Bill was like a madman, shouting and yelling his triumph for my win. But I found out later, his delight was for himself, for he had won a new shirt and pants by betting on my team. He even forgot to congratulate me, as all the others did, as soon as I can get my breath to acknowledge my thanks. Pierre and the Jasper man fought for third place, but the Jasper man beat him in a closer finish than my own win. In that the judges had some doubt about it, but Pierre acknowledged his defeat. He told me afterwards, by gar, he didn't care as long as an Edmonton man won first. So yeah, New Year's races, big deal. And really, yeah, the whole festive season was a huge part of the seasonal round. And yeah, I hope that some of these stories and accounts bring some joy to your holiday season. I present to you my bibliography. I'm just gonna note that the underline ones are actually, they were really useful because they were compilations of primary sources rather than secondary sources. And so they were super useful in getting a well fleshed out view of Métis winter festivities. But yeah, in effect, dancing, socializing, sport, and community were really what made Métis winter festivities the most wonderful time of the year, or as we might say, le meilleur temps de l'année. Yeah, I think that's it.
Awesome. Thanks so much, Matt. So I think now is our time where we get to do some Q&A questions. And I think we've already got a few here that have come up in the chat. Unless, John, did you have anything you wanted to add?
Just one quick one. I was wondering what double ball was.
Oh, yeah, that's a really good one. It's an interesting game, mostly played by women, actually. But it plays kind of similar to lacrosse. But you have a stick, and you have two balls tethered together, and you effectively use the stick to pass these tethered balls around across the field. And there's a few different rule sets. Some will have three posts, and you have to round the rear post before scoring on the center post. Some will just have two posts, more like a conventional like soccer or hockey game, and you just need to get the ball on the rear post.
Sounds like a very intense, interesting game. Is it still played today at all, or just in accounts?
I mean, I don't know a lot of people who play it much in their everyday life, but I know I've seen it played a lot at a lot of historic sites. And honestly, like, we used to do it at Fort Edmonton when no one was around, just to kill time and have fun. So kind of, I guess. I don't know. Depends how you look at it, I guess. And it might also be played in some communities that I'm not aware of too, still. So.
Yeah, that's fair. So I gotta say, my, which just maybe says a lot about me, my takeaway from this presentation is thinking about Kissing Day, and how much fun that must have been. And I think January 1st needs a rebrand, but.
Brings new meaning to New Year Kiss, no?
Pardon?
Brings new meaning to New Year's Kiss, no?
Yeah, I need a whole community. That's just COVID talking. Anyway, we've got lots of questions about the, kind of related to that. So the questions are, how many couples do you think would have met at those dances? And then as a follow-up, if you, people met and that worked out, how were marriages arranged? I think that was referring to something that came up in your presentation.
So I can't quantify how many couples met at dances, but I would imagine a lot. And the reason I say that is that courting periods were generally only a month or two among Métis. And if you look at the timeline between the early Christmas festivities of mid-December and the height of marriage season in January, it lines up pretty well.
All right.
So I can't give you an exact number, but I would guess that a lot of the couples got together at those events.
Mm-hmm. Totally. That sounds like a great time. Now, the other question we have here is, how many of these traditions carry on today? But I'm going to add to this because I know this holiday season for a lot of us is where we kind of get to rekindle our cultural traditions. And I'm just wondering, of the traditions that carry on today, what are also some of your favorites that you've personally practiced with your family?
So what's interesting, and I actually didn't have a chance to get into this because of space constraints, but I found that a lot of these traditions really did continue into the 20th century, and in particular, dances and carols. I don't think I actually got around to mentioning it, but several of the sources I consulted discussed Christmas caroling. And a lot of the tunes aren't incredibly different from what we do today. And I've heard a lot of stories of Christmas dancing. I know my family, if you get a Scottish reel going at Christmas time, there's gonna be someone on the floor. I say that because that happened yesterday. That's crazy. Wasn't me either.
you're a victim.
Yeah, my brother and sister just went for it. But the dancing is a big thing. The visiting, I think that's pretty universal to anyone who celebrates Christmas. The socializing, the cavorting, the... Oh, one thing I didn't touch on, and I really meant to, but I think I forgot to put in my notes. Gift giving was a thing during the festive season. But it was actually reserved for New Year's. Yeah. Several accounts mentioned that we didn't give gifts on Christmas like we do today. We gave them on New Year's. So I thought that was neat. And so gift giving is one of those things you can see as both continuous and disjunctive, in the sense that there was a tradition of gift giving, but the day it's done on has changed.
And know why that might have been? Why they waited until New Year's Day for that?
Because Christmas was the church holiday, New Year's was the party holiday. Also, Midnight Mass, actually, now that I'm thinking about continuities, I remember going to Midnight Mass as a kid, so. Yeah, that's a thing.
That's great.
So there's a few, to be sure.
Awesome. I'll just invite anyone who's still watching, if you do have any questions for Matt, just pop them up in the chat, and then they'll get passed along to us so that we can answer them.
I want to actually go back. There was one question follow-up. Were the marriages arranged? Mm-hmm. Yes, no, kind of, and it's complicated. A lot of what I've read suggests that while they were technically arranged marriages, the bride actually had a lot of say up to the point of veto power over who a marriage was arranged with. One interesting story that's actually local to Calgary is that of Sam and Jane Livingston. And there's an interesting story about how she convinced her dad to try and talk to Sam about marrying her. So officially there was an arrangement between the father and the bride and the groom-to-be, but there is substantial historic evidence that the women had a lot more agency than they did in a lot of, than they do in a lot of other arranged marriage circumstances. Mm-hmm. So just getting back to that question, were they arranged officially? But like, there was definitely something to be said for marriage of preference.
Nice. Yeah. All right, so another question we have from Alyssa has to do with, did they have Christmas trees?
Nope. Christmas trees and Santa were probably the two things that we associate most with Christmas today that weren't, that didn't come up at all. Mm. So interestingly enough, things like gold trim and braid and boughs of holly are referenced. The actual tree is not. Yeah.
Do you think that has to do with the Roman origins of the Christmas tree? And that's not really...
Kind of. The one thing that I think a lot of people, when they hear the word tradition, I think they just kind of assume that it's been a thing since forever. A lot of our Christmas traditions in English-speaking North America today have emerged in the past 150 years or less. Mm-hmm. Santa, for example, is very much like Santa as we know him today, is very much a 20th century thing. Mm-hmm. And even the Christmas tree didn't really emerge until late 19th century in mainstream British society, let alone in the colonies. Mm-hmm. So these things that we associate with Christmas and that we have all this mythos tying back to, like, you know, pagan times and whatnot. I mean, there is truth to that, but it's not so simple as we've always done this. There's always been an ebb and flow of certain traditions. And during the 19th century in Métis communities, actually, even in English-speaking communities in Eastern Canada or Britain, neither Santa nor Christmas trees were especially prominent.
Great. So you had a lot of fantastic images, as I know you mentioned at the beginning. You're like, I have so many great pieces of art in this presentation. So a question from John is, where did you find the images? And was there a lot of sifting around through the archives to find them?
Remarkably little. I was actually surprised about how much of a backlog I just had on my hard drive. But Cornelius Craighoff appears to have been very active in Red River one winter. I don't know why, I don't know how, I don't know the logistics of it. But I would say about half the paintings in that presentation are Craighoff's. And that's just because he happened to be in Red River for a winter. It was quite amazing because, like, literally I spent hours at first and then I found this one image and I was like, oh, that's really good. Search more images similar to this. Google gave me Cornelius Craighoff. Didn't even say winter, just straight up, just Cornelius Craighoff. And that was probably more than I had seen up to that point. It was really quite amazing.
Neat. So back to talking about sort of the traditions or the practices around dancing and singing. Were there any particular songs that were played on the fiddle around Christmas time?
Most of the sources I consulted just said fiddling. I do recall one source that mentioned a few songs, and these aren't necessarily Christmas songs, but they're still quite popular in the Métis community today. And those were the Red River Jig, of course, Buffalo Gals, and Whiskey Before Breakfast. Drops of Brandy I also read was quite a popular tune. So yeah, they were the kind of tunes you would have heard at any Métis event, and actually really still do today. But you have to bear in mind that you're going to hear more fiddling and see more dancing in that 3 to 4 week time span than probably throughout the rest of the year put together. And so I think for a lot of Métis people in the 19th century, those songs would have actually had more of a Christmas association than they do today.
Yeah, that makes sense. All right, so we've got a question from Mike back to the Kissing Day story. We're all loving that story. In your story, you said that they invited the elder in for tea. Was there specific kinds of tea more liked in the winter season?
Black tea.
Oh, okay.
You go to any, even today, actually, that's something there's a lot of continuity for. You go to any Métis household today, there's always a box of red rose, I tell ya. Black tea is really the tea. And you might add a few local herbs for flavor, but at the end of the day, is black tea. I wish I could elaborate on that more. But actually, no, I do have a story for this.
Oh, okay, great.
Father Lacombe once wrote that the only le seule façon que les Métis sont un peuple athée, ceci est parce que leur amour de la thé. Which translates to the only way it's a pun in French, but it doesn't work as well in English. The only way you could call the Métis an atheist people. So in French, atheist is athée, is because of their love of tea. The only way you could call them, because athée can also mean of tea. Hmm. So it's, yeah, anyways. But yeah, Métis love their black tea. There's one story I read from Edmonton of a community of 100 people purchasing something like 8 tons of tea for a season. Now I did the math, and that would be the equivalent of, I think it was 4 or 5 boxes of black tea per person per day. So probably they were trading some of this away. That's still a lot of tea.
I hope so. That's a lot of caffeine. That's a crazy.
I actually tried to replicate it once. I think I got 25 grams in before I threw up.
Oh, I mean, I guess you did it for both history and science. So good for you. That's great.
I was able to definitively discern that they were not drinking all that tea.
Okay.
because I drink a lot of tea, and if I can't handle that much,
too much.
There's no way a 3-year-old in that community is drinking that much.
Yeah, hopefully not. Okay. Well, I'll maybe leave it one more time for more questions.
Terrific tea stories.
anyone has any more questions? I guess what how we'll maybe wrap up if we don't have any other panel questions from our audience is I'll invite Jackie Kleiner from Chinook Country Historic Society to say a few words. So if Jackie wants to come on screen.
Hey, so that was fascinating, Matt. So much fun, and you know, we need some fun topics right at the moment. So it was great to think about a time when holidays were and traditions were experienced by other folks, and maybe we can pick up on some of those. Like Holly said, maybe the kissing. We can start with the kissing. Although right now we can't kiss anybody. Never mind. Other people. So maybe that's for next year.
This wouldn't be the first Christmas of the Métis community that's been interrupted thusly. Christmas of 1870-1871 was marked by a smallpox epidemic, and that year no one left the settlements in the Edmonton district to go to Edmonton for Christmas because there was such fear of disease. So there's continuity in a few different ways. Suffice to say, it's not the first time we've been through this, and we'll get through it.
How about the pandemic of 1918, the Spanish influenza?
That fell a bit outside of the scope of my research. As I said, I wanted to basically do everything from like 1750 up to the modern era. There was literally too much data for me to deal with. So I kind of went for that golden age period.
Right. Okay. Well, we can think about how we want to implement that in the future. So thank you very, very much for making your presentation today. And I really want to thank Lougheed House and the Calgary Public Library for partnering with us at Chinook Country Historical Society in adding this event. And it's great to be able to, as I say, focus on something a little more fun and a little bit more interesting than maybe some of the things that we've done in the past, in that this has been quite different than some of our presentations. Before I leave, I just want to make sure that we wish everyone the best of the season, happy holidays, and whatever traditions you are going to be able to participate in this year. And to remind you that we do have two presentations in January already set up. One on January 7th, Josh Traptow from Heritage Calgary will be talking about royal visits to Calgary, which will be fascinating, I'm sure. He is quite the monarchist, so he'll have some good stories. And on January 21st, we will be having a presentation by Leah Christensen, who will be presenting on her book and her 25 years of considering those beautiful mountains we get to look at, the Rockies, the art of the Canadian Rockies, and 25 years of research and wandering. Two good things to look forward to in January. So back to you, John, to wrap up. And again, thanks so much, Matt. And thank you, Holly and Lougheed House for bringing this presentation to us.
You're welcome. Thanks so much, everyone.
And thanks for having me.
It was a pleasure. So thank you again. And thank you for all the audience as well. This has been fantastic. If you're interested in those programs that Jackie mentioned there, or any other ones, you can check out calgarylibrary.ca/programs, and that will get you to any interesting online programs that are coming up. So thank you again, Matt, and have a great night, everyone.